Hello everyone, welcome back on the series on DSP processor. In this lecture I am going to tell you more detail on interrupt sources. As the previous lecture I have covered some basic definitions on interrupts. In this lecture I am going to cover the interrupts in more detail in a further way. Okay, so what topics I will cover in this lecture, these are the interrupt sources, maskable interrupt processing, we will look at the maskable interrupt processing, PI, peripheral interrupt expansion, we will go to the detail, PI vector table, why that is used, interrupt latency, how much time it is taking to cover for the one interrupts for two process, and the timer interrupts. At the last we will look at the timer interrupts. As you can see in the slides that F2833X has a large number of interrupt sources. As you can see here, it has a large number of interrupt sources, and that is 96 total, and similarly it has 14 maskable interrupts that can be enabled or disabled. So 96 interrupt sources and 14 maskable interrupts. So the question is, how can we handle this bottleneck? So obviously we have to use a single interrupt line for the multiple sources, and each interrupt line is connected to its interrupt vector, that is 32-bit memory space inside a vector table. This memory space, that is the 32-bit memory space inside a vector table, hold the address for interrupt service routine. In case of multiple interrupts, this service routine must be used for all incoming interrupt requests. This technique forces the programmer to use a software-based separation method on entry of this service routine. This method will cost an additional time that is often not available in real-time application. So, how to speed up this interrupts? So the answer is, using the peripheral interrupt expansion, we can speed up the interrupt request. How it do? The unit expand a vector table, vector address table, into the larger scale, and keep reserving a 32-bit entries for each of the 96 possible interrupt sources. An interrupt responds with the help of this unit. It's much faster than without it. To use the PI, we have to remap the location of interrupt vector table into the table address. This is in the volatile memory. Before we can use this memory, we have to initialize it. Don't worry about it. We'll talk in detail how can we initialize it in the subsequent slides. So before going to the code, before going on the PI vector table in the detail, and before we dive into the PI registers, we have to discuss the remaining path from an interrupt request to its acknowledged by the digital signal controller. As you can see in the slide that we have to close two more switches to reach the core, to reach the core of the processor. So we have to close the IER switch and we have to close the IMTM switch. This is the global switch, this is the local switch. We have to close two switches to reach the core of the processor. So first, what we have to do, a valid signal on the IFR will cause the latch to display a 1 in the appropriate bit, and if the individual switch are turned on and the global switch are turned on, then interrupt request, let us take an example. If we want to use this interrupt 1, so we have the valid signal will be 1, and we have to close this switch and this switch to reach to the core of the processor. So So if the individual and the global switch are turned on, the interrupt reaches to the core. Now we'll talk about what is the IFR, what is the IER, and what is the interrupt global switch. So the IFR, that is known as the interrupt flag register, are the 16 bit, and each bit will be the 1 bit. Okay, sorry. These are the 16 bit. As you can see here, let's take an example. If you want to clear, if you there is the some interrupt request are pending and interrupts are absent, or if there are some interrupt requests are pending, that bit will be equivalent to 1, and if their interrupt requests are absent, so that bit will be equal to 0. That means there is no interrupt request, that bit will be 0. If there is interrupt request are there, that is the pending request, so that bit will be 1. So let us take an example. We can set them manually or clear the IFR manually. So how can we set? We can use IFR. Let us take an example. We want to set the IFR in interrupt request. We have a interrupt request, the fourth number interrupt request, INT4. So we want to set that bit. So how can we use? We can make corresponding that bit equals to 1. If you want to make corresponding that bit equals to 1, the remaining bit will be the 0. And we are making the OR operation. So what will the OR operation? Let us take an example. The so we have last four numbers 0A, 0, 0, 0, 1. And we are making the OR operation. Whatever IFR bit will be there previously. So let us take an example. IFR bit will be X, 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 X previously. So we are making the OR operations. So that will be 1. And that bit will be 1. And remaining will be depending upon the these bits. So it will be X, X, and X. So we have set the INT 4, interrupt 4 in IFR. So we have a request. Then we have we make the INT 4 in the IFR we have set. And if you want to clear the request, we have no request and we want to clear that bit. So similarly, we can use F, F, F and the 7. We can make a AND operation with that. So we can clear the particular bit. So compiler generate automatic instruction for setting and clearing IFR. If interrupts occurs when we are writing the IFR, the interrupt has a priority. IFR bit that will be cleared when interrupt is acknowledged by the CPU. The IFR bit will be cleared if the interrupt has been acknowledged by the CPU. That time the IFR will be cleared. There will be no interrupt request will be there. Now the interrupts will be absent because that is acknowledged by the CPU. Now register cleared on the register. So interrupt flag register will be cleared on the reset. Similarly, the IER register will be the local switch, so which we have to close to reach the one step to reach to the core. So what is that? That is similar to same number of bits, that is similar to the IFR registers. So we can set and we can clear. So set means that bit particular corresponding bits will be 1, and clear means corresponding bit will be 0. So similarly, we can set and clear manually, same as previously that we have gone through the IFR register. So we can make a OR operation, we can make a AND operation. OR operation for this set the interrupt for, and AND operation for the clear. So similarly, compiler generate automatic instruction for setting and clear IER, and register clear on reset. This is the final stage when we have to the interrupt will reach to the core before. This is the final stage for this. So depending upon the bit INTM, depending upon the value of INTM, the interrupt request will be sent to the core or reach to the core. So interrupts INTM used globally enable disable interrupts. So for enabling, we have to initialize INTM equals to 0, and disable we have to initialize INTM equals to 1. So INTM modified from the assembly code only. While writing the code, we can modify the INTM whether we want to switch on the global switch and we want to turn off the global switch. And these are the global interrupts. How can we initialize in the code? So we have to write ASM brackets clear INTM and for enable global interrupt and for the disable set C INTM to disable global interrupts. So these are the main part of before going to detail of the peripheral interrupt expansion. These are the main parts which we have to know about that. So now the thing is, there are all 96 possible sources are grouped into 12 lines and 8 sources per line. Okay, as you can see in this view, you can easily understand that we have a total 96 interrupt sources. As you can see, we have a total 96 interrupts, as you can see here, and each 96 interrupt sources are grouped into the 12 group. As you can see, these are the 12 groups, 96 modules, and each groups have 8 sources per line. So each group has 8 sources. So for 8 sources further have IFR register, IER register, and global switch to reach to the core. So similarly, to enable and disable the individual sources, we have to program the another group of register, that is PI IFR and PI IER registers. Other than that, as you can see here, we have two more interrupts, as you can see here, that is the timer interrupts. These are the timer unit, timer 0 and timer 2. We will talk about the timer modules also in this lecture in detail in the subsequent slides. So now we'll talk about the we want to use the individual switch, we want to enable the individual sources. So we have to use the individual PI registers. So how can we use that? So we have a PI registers, we have a different set of register to reach to the core. So first we have to use IFR register, then IER register, the PI acknowledge register, and the PI control registers. So these are the some bit format. These are 16 bit here. These are defined like this manner. So how can we use this? Let us take an example. We want to manually set the IFR for interrupt 1 in the PI group 1. So in the PI group 1, we want to manually set. So how can we write? This is the PI control register dot PI IFR 1 dot bit dot INT x4 equals to 1. So INT x4 will be here. So IFR bit we have to manually we can set. We have an interrupt request. Now we can enable the captured area CAP interrupt in a PI group 3. In the PI group 3, how can we write PI control register, the PI group PI IR, these are the group 3 dot bit dot interrupt x5 equals to 1. So we are writing the IR 3. So these are the group 3. And in the group 3 we want to acknowledge the bit. So similarly we are writing corresponding bits and the PI control register we want to enable the PI. So this is the process and all interrupt sources are connected to interrupt lines according to this assignment table. As you can see here, this is the total assignment tables and each interrupt lines are connected to each interrupt sources are connected to interrupt line according to this assignment table. So let us take an example. If there is an interrupt request from the ADC, so this is first interrupts interrupt from the interrupt 1 and this is the interrupt x.6. So for ADC we have to write interrupt 1.6 because it is the interrupt 1 and the sixth group. Similarly for EPWM, that 2, okay, interrupt. So EPWM 2 is, as you can see here, so that will be 3.2, sorry, here it is wrong, it will be 3.2, and SCI, now we want to use SCI TX INTA, so that is here, 9th group, and second. So INT 9.2. like this we have to use the interrupts from the interrupt vector table. Once the interrupt request has been acknowledged by the CPU, an automatic hardware context switch sequence is started. It includes an autosave of 14 internal registers with all important internal control and status bit, and loads the program counter with the address of the ISR. That means that once the interrupt has been acknowledged by the CPU, whatever program is running in the background, the 14 important registers with all important control and status bit registers will be saved. That will be auto save, and corresponding which interrupt request has been sent to the ISR corresponding to that bit will be cleared in IFR, and that will be and corresponding to IR bit also cleared, and it will disable all the interrupts and debug events similarly, and load the program counter with the address of the ISR, and it will clear all the other status bits, that is the loop, it will clear loop, it will allow ELO and idle state. Again, but there are some other actions that is simultaneously working, and they are known uninterruptible. So interrupt latency, so how much time it is taking to respond the interrupts, if as you can see here, if the interrupts internal interrupts are there, so it will take 14 cycle if internal interrupts occurs, and if the external interrupts occurs, so it will include two more extra cycle to complete the operation. So so the minimum latency, that is internal for interrupt, internal interrupts, it will be 14 cycle, and for the external interrupt it will be 16 cycle, and the maximum latency will be depends on the wait state, ready and INTM, etc. The F2833X features three independent 32-bit core timers. The block diagram of one of the timer is shown in the slides. So as you can see here, the clock source is an internal clock source, which is usually 150 MHz. Assuming that the external oscillator frequency is 30 MHz and PLL ratio of 10/2. Once the timer is enabled using TCR.4 registers, then the incoming clock counts down a 16-bit prescaler. On underflow, it generates a borrow signal which will drive another 32-bit counter which count down. And at the end of this counter is also generated underflow, and interrupt request is transferred to the CPU. In DSP TMS320X28335, timer 1 and timer 2 are usually used by Texas Instruments for the real-time operation system, that is DSP and BIOS, whereas timer 0 is generally free for general users. Timer 0 is only one timer of the CPU that goes through the PI peripheral interrupt expansion, as you can see in the slide, whereas timer 1 and timer 2 are usually used by the Texas Instruments for the real-time applications. A timer unit is usually initialized by the set of registers. We will perform an exercise with the registers of the CPU timer 0. However, instead of setting every bit by ourselves, we will use a hardware abstraction function which we only have to specify the desired time period and the clock speed of our processor. This function is provided by the Texas Instruments as a part of such function. So we will use that function in the next lecture when we are do the programming, and we will explain each and every terms related to interrupts and the timer unit. And there are some timer registers which are shown here. Timer 0 includes the several set of registers. Timers 1 and timer 2 are the same, all have a several set of registers. Counter registers high. These are period register low and period register high. And control register, prescaler register and prescaler register high. The same set of register will be for the timer 1 and timer 2. But timer 1 and timer 2 are used for the real-time application by the Texas Instruments, and timer 0 can be used by the user. It is freely available. So there are some of the control set of registers of the timer unit. As you can see here, TSS is the timer stop status. If we want to start, it will be 0, and we want to stop, it will be 1. And timer reload bit, that will be 1 on the reload. We want to reload the timer. And the software emulation free, emulation interaction will be 1x equals to run free. And TIE, timer interrupt enabled, write 1 to enable interrupts. This bit will be write 1 to enable interrupts. And timer interrupt flag, write 1 to clear the flag. Our next lecture, we will cover the basic programming related to DSP interrupts. We will go through some basic example on LED blinking. And first we will look at using the for loop, and we will see the advantage using the timer interrupts. And we will see how to initialize the timer in Code Composer Studio. We will see in the Code Composer Studio in the next lecture. And till now, if you didn't subscribe my channel, subscribe it. And if you have any doubt, comment me on comment section. Thank you.